I'm in the process of having one of my nephews is about to do a school paper on the Currency Act.
Yes.
And I don't know where to research. And if you could, you give me a brief synopsis of just prior to the Currency Act, what the colonies were like and what caused this to come about and what the gist of the result was. I guess maybe, so how would I explain it to a third party if because it's so, such an important event?
Well, you know, it's rather reassuring. We're seeing a lot of young people now start to go out and read about the Currency Act as the cause of the American Revolution. In fact, I think it was about 2 weeks ago, these two high schoolers did a video about it, a very nice video expose. But in short, before the American Revolution, Ben Franklin was the colonist's ambassador to Great Britain. And when he was over there talking with the British court, he got to see the horrible poverty that was gripping England at the time as a result of the Bank of England. Massive unemployment, massive hunger, if you've ever read the works of Charles Dickens, or if you study what the East End was like about the time of Jack the Ripper, that was kind of what was going on. And the people in the court were asking Ben Franklin what the colonies were doing about their unemployed and they're hungry and homeless. And Ben Franklin says, "We don't have any." And they go, "What?" And he says, "Well, you know, we're printing our own money. The colonial governments are printing our own money. We always make sure there's enough money flowing through commerce for everybody to have a job and everybody to be prosperous." And when the Bank of England got wind of that, they went into a panic because the last thing they needed was to see, you know, the American colonies with state-issued value-based currency and the people prospering, because it was going to give the British people bad ideas about maybe wanting to do exactly the same thing. So they lobbied King George III to pass the Currency Act, which ordered everybody in the colonies to conduct their business only using banknotes borrowed at interest from the Bank of England. And within the space of just a couple of years, the colonies were plunged into exactly the same poverty and privation and joblessness and hunger that England itself was involved with. And that was what really fueled the anger for the American Revolution. If you go back and you read the writings of Ben Franklin and Thomas Jefferson, and they say right in there, it was the Currency Act that led to the American Revolution. So we fought a revolution to break free of private central banking. We set up the U.S. Treasury, which created all the currency, spent it into circulation to buy what the government needed. The money, the currency flowed through circulation, powering commerce without accruing interest to a private bank, and then was taxed back at the same amount to close the cycle and balance the books. And it worked very well, and that's why the United States was this economic and industrial powerhouse during its early years. Because nations with private central banks cannot compete with nations that are free from private central banks. So the private central bankers, having lost the revolution, they came in and tried to set up a private central bank with their agent in place, Alexander Hamilton. And they created the first bank of the United States. It had a 20-year charter. And at the end of that 20 years, the United States was back into that same banker-imposed hunger, poverty, starvation, massive joblessness. And the bankers were getting rich off of all of this. So Congress voted not to renew the charter for the first bank of the United States. This was in 1811. And the Rothschilds literally came in and threatened the United States Congress, "If you do not renew our banking charter, we will arrange a war for you." And Congress said no. And so the Rothschild Bank of England went to the British Crown and said, "If you want to recolonize the Americas, we'll loan you the money to do it at very, very low interest rates." Britain said, "Yeah, great idea." And the next thing you know, you got the War of 1812. Now, the U.S. won the War of 1812, but it put the United States into such dire economic straits, they were forced to charter a new central bank, which was called the Second Bank of the United States, also with a 20-year charter. And at the end of that 20 years, once again, the American people were suffering hunger, joblessness, starvation, and the bankers were getting insanely rich. And Andrew Jackson made it the flagship, if you will, of his second term in office to shut down the bank. And he succeeded in doing so, whereupon there was an immediate attempt to assassinate him. And so basically that's what the Currency Act was. What we're looking at is all of history is a war between banking systems, between these predatory, privately owned banks who want to take the public currency away from being a public utility and turn it into just another profit-making scheme for the bankers. And it is a failed system because inevitably these private central banks create more debt than money to pay the debt, and everybody gets trapped in the debt. You can't have private central banking without it resulting in homelessness, joblessness, and hunger. It's impossible because there isn't enough money out there to pay all the debt. And that's really what it comes down to. All right, we're going to go to Frank in Pennsylvania. Aloha, Frank. Welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Okay, Michael, thank you for taking my call. You know, I heard you talking about the War of 1812 and the banking system. There's a piece of information that people might not be aware of. The Prime Minister of England was called a man, Spencer Percival, and he was a very good man. He was a righteous man, and he was against going to war with the United States. He knew it was a banking war. And in May of 1812, he was assassinated, the only prime minister ever to be assassinated. And once he was assassinated, you can line up the dates, war was declared on the United States. So there were people even on the opposite side of the ocean that was against going to war, but it always seemed that they end their demise with either bullets or they were taken out of office somehow. And I'd just like you to give that piece of information.
That is an interesting piece of information. I'm going to add it to that article, All Wars Are Bankers' Wars. As I mentioned before, when Andrew Jackson succeeded in shutting down the Second Bank of the United States, there was an immediate assassination attempt on his life, which failed when both pistols used by the assassin malfunctioned. When Abraham Lincoln found himself going into having to deal with the secession of the Confederacy, the bankers were willing to finance his war at like 30% interest, and Lincoln said, I'm not going to enslave the white people to the banks to free the black people. So he exercised his authority as President of the United States, and he issued his own money, the greenback, and it worked so well that once the war was over, Lincoln said, we're going to keep on doing this. And of course then John Wilkes Booth shot Lincoln, and as soon as Lincoln was dead, the greenbacks were taken out of circulation and destroyed. Then you had John F. Kennedy, who issued Executive Order 11110 that put a new U.S. government-issued currency, the United States note, into circulation, backed by the silver that was in Fort Knox at the time, about $4.5 billion worth of currency floating through circulation on which interest was not accruing to the Federal Reserve. 5 months later, Kennedy was assassinated. The United States notes were taken out of circulation and almost all of them destroyed. There are still examples of them in collectors' hands right now. And on the Warren Commission sat John J. McCloy, president of the Chase Manhattan Bank, president of the World Bank, and I don't care how good a banker he is, he has no business being on a committee that's supposed to be investigating the murder of the president, unless he was there to make sure the financial dimensions never surfaced.
Mike, you're absolutely right. It's out in plain sight. A high school student could connect the dots. Every time anybody got close, their demise was either met with bullets or they were taken out of office. And the last thing I can say is also Ronald Reagan in 1980 when he was campaigning. Remember, he was campaigning also against the Fed, and he wanted to reveal the Federal Reserve member banks. And he almost met his demise with an assassination attempt. So it seems anybody that was for changing our currency to the actual constitutional lawful money of gold and silver always meant a horrible demise. But it also happened on the other side of the ocean. I appreciate you putting up that stuff about Spencer Percival. He was a righteous man. He was a good man. I have an autobiography a biography that was wrote on him, and I believe that he knew exactly that we were going to get into another banker's war, and he was dead set against sending young men to die in another banker war.
All righty. Well, I will look that up, and it is an important thing to add to that, all wars are bankers' wars, because once you make that paradigm shift and understand these private central banks are willing to lie, cheat, steal, kill, and start wars to keep their scam going, then all of a sudden, all of American history makes a great deal more sense.